Welcome back to part 2. As I said, the two cops are getting watched over by a British bird. Sounds a little bit awkward, but actually it isn't. So anyway, they're starting to make a plan how to ditch the dodo, and during this little whispering time they share, Suzu makes wrong conclusions, which lead us to the following scene, in which he explains that, well,
betrothed, intended, affianced.
Meaning?
One day you two are going to be married.
Yeah. Which is, let's just say, not really in their kind of plan. I wonder why. Anyway, this leads us to Just Can't Wait to Begin, which gets a 5 out of 5 from me. Yeah, I think this song is fucking good. It's really good. Even the visual style, even though it looks more like the creators and animators were on crack while they were making this part. But no, I am actually aware of the fact that they just were inspired by African art. So anyway, Suzu lands under a rhino's ass. I don't get it either. How the fuck did he get there? Anyway, and yeah, the two cops get away, and now we have this scene. This little scene is kind of awkward, and let me explain why. Okay, first of all, you could probably make this little joke just go like, we know who's going to be on top on the relationship, and the other thing, you know what I mean. Wow, who the fuck activated my music box? Anyway, so yeah, by Simba's pouncing try on his future girlfriend, he lands under her. God, this sounds awkward. yeah. If you have no idea what I'm even talking about, then you should probably stop watching this video and, because, well, how do I tell you the right way? You're probably too young to watch my videos. And that says a lot. Okay. Besides that, he tries it once again, and in the second try, they land on Oria in the middle of the elephant graveyard, because they're rolling down a hill. But he's still under her! Well, by the way, that's not just for giggles and fun. It's also a very important point later on in the movie. But enough of that now. They start exploring the elephant graveyard, but before they can enter an elephant skull, they get stopped by their British watchover bird, which tells them, well, they should probably the only checking they're going to do is check out here. Because, well, as we learn a few seconds after this, first of all, Simba's kind of a pussy. Well, surprise! Second of all, it does show really that you're brave when you're hiding behind your watchover bird and your future girlfriend. Yeah, probably. That's brave as hell. Anyway, the hyenas appear, and well, we have Shenzi, voiced by none other than Whoopi Goldberg, known for such classic movies as Star Trek Generations. Yeah, thumbs down. I know it. I just know it. Yeah. I like it. Yeah. Oh, you have bad comments and hate mail. Oh my god, yeah, I really like it, yeah. Not such shitty movies as, for example, Sisters Act. Oh yeah, more hate mails. Oh yeah. Anyway, where was I? Oh yeah, Whoopi Goldberg. Yeah. And we learned that the elephant grave is hyena territory, and Simba tries to talk his way out of the situation because, well, he's the future king, and actually, they should probably be very impressed by that, considering the fact that his father is Darth Vader. Mufasa. Sorry, I just get sometimes characters confused if they share the same voice. Okay, so this kind of fails, and they ending up getting chased by the hyenas. Well, after they try to cook Zuzu, I don't get it either. I mean, he's fucking British. Why does everyone try to eat him? He's British. He tastes probably like ass. But whatever. Maybe they're really that hungry. Anyway, after they intended to do, as I said, cook Zuzu, I don't get it either. Simba, he goes with his, hey, why don't you pick on somebody your own size? A kid, that doesn't work if you have another rocket launcher in your hand and are dressed up like, yeah, okay. I do believe that this is not how it really works. But it did work better in Kick-Ass, and it was not that much laughable. In this case, it's adorable and laughable too. Doi moment. Well, he realizes a millisecond after this that, well, he's the only target to be picked on when it comes to person at their own size. He is half as big as them, but whatever. They're meant to be dumb, so yeah, it does make sense. Anyway, they chase him and his future girlfriend through the whole elephant graveyard, and they end up in some kind of bone cage. Anyway, Simba tries to scare him away, like a mouse, but fares miserably, like a mouse. Because his so-called roar sounds more like, how do I take it the right way without insulting anyone? Yeah, a cat meow. Very adorable try, but yeah, you're probably going to be eaten alive. Well, he tries a second time, and actually does sound in the first moment as if he had actually accomplished something, but not quite really, because this is just his father appearing out of nowhere, beating the crap out of the hyenas, and sending them away and warning them that if they come ever again near his son, that he will probably have a better idea. I'll let it say by this guy.
Consequences will never be the same.
You heard that, Redneck? Okay. So, consequences will never be the same. Anyway, after this whole incident, Mufasa tells to his son that, well, being brave doesn't mean to look for trouble. He's just only brave when he needs to be. Yeah, for example, when he has to chuck off the hand of his son. God damn it, I get characters confused so often. Sorry. Okay. He is not Darth Vader. Okay, where was I? Yeah. They're only brave when he needs to be brave, which is a good lesson to every kind of kid around the world and stuff. And anyway, he also tells him that, well, all the dead kings are living as stars in the sky. Yeah, it sounds awkward when I say this, doesn't it? But it's a kid's movie, and it is supposed to make them feel not that bad, and that make give them hope. That's the probably most important part. If they had lose a family member, for example, that they can just think about this kind of stuff to make them feel better. It's a very nice and warm scene. Also interlaid with some music by none other than Hans Zimmer. My goodness, this guy's music has balls, has its own balls, as well as James Earl Jones' voice has its own balls. Okay, anyway. We see also some kind of a symbolism scene when Simba taps into the paw print of his father and realizes that, well, his paw is just slightly smaller. Anyway, after the scene, we have the next song on the Elephant Graveyard, sung by none other than Jeremy Irons as Scar, Be Prepared. To be honest, the song itself is very good, but how do I say this? Scar dances around like a fucking ballerina, and I can't take this any kind of way serious. It is just the kind of girly way he dances around, and okay, wait, I'm just going to rate the song, not the visuals in this case. I give it a 4.5 out of 5. It is impressive, to be honest, but the whole hyena parts just make it a little bit a little bit less intimidating. If I would rate it with the visual parts, I would probably get a 2 out of 5, but in this case, 4.5 out of 5. Yeah. He explains that, well, he's trying to use the hyenas to kiss Simba and Mufasa. Well, that's what he is going to do, and then next day in the gorge, where he tells his nephew that, well, his father has a marvelous surprise for him, and well, that his nephew is such a naughty boy. Considering those kind of things, I would say that he's a pedophile. Nobody surprised? Okay, whatever. And, yeah. He then walks off and leaves Simba in the middle of the gorge on a stone. And, yes, orders the hyenas to start a hunt stampede, which is what they do. During the stampede, Simba runs away from the stampede, and, yeah. Scar walks off to get his brother, who then decides to save his son, actually accomplishes this goal, and, but, well, to be honest, he's not quite able to save himself. For a moment, though, it looks like he is actually saved, which is why his son is walking somewhere to get to him through the rocks. It's a little bit complicated because it's not quite sure where the hell he's going. Anyway, and that, as we see, Scar is, well, a dark soul, scarred by his past. And if you have read certain fanfics, and if you have read certain Wikipedia articles or other background story, if you know that, then you're probably aware of the fact that, well, yeah, his past was kind of fucked up. But if you're not, that's not the problem, because, well, the reasons why he killed his brother are as crystal clear as possible. As I said, that's why most people think it's Hamlet-based. Wait a second. Sorry, I stood up last night a little bit too late. Okay, well, actually, I was just like 4 a.m. It's actually not night anymore. That's early morning. But anyway, as I said, his motives are crystal clear. He's pissed off because he can't be king. Well, duh. Anyway, he throws his brother off a cliff, and yeah, Vaz dies. Horrible. Dies a horrible death in the middle of a stampede.